Hey, how's it going, criminals and cutthroats? Welcome to the Stream of Blood. My name's Jared Logan, your game master for this evening, and you have tuned in to our ongoing Blades in the Dark interactive world campaign, Blood and Blades. And tonight we are bringing the first, the original, the best crew of our crews, our collaboration with the Glass Cannon Network. We are bringing you the Tin Whistles for a little session of Blood and Glass. I'm so happy that you could join us tonight. We are so happy to be here. This promises to be another exciting downtime session. If you had told me when we started playing Blades in the Dark that downtime, I kind of almost look forward to it more than the score sometimes, because it's just filled with so many juicy, meaty, just glistening hooks to hook our players into different plot lines to kind of discover who they are with their psychology, but also it's filled with strategy. There's a lot of really important and crucial choices to make during a downtime phase in Blades in the Dark, and boy, does our crew need to make some key choices during this downtime, because their last score was well, it was a mixed bag, to put it in a very diplomatic way. There were some ups, there were some downs. As the Big Lebowski would say, a lot of ins and outs in this case. A lot of ins and outs. I'm going to bring them in to talk about it right now. Let's start with our Stream of Blood favorite. The golden son of Stream of Blood. Our good pal, incredible improviser and actor, playing pretty Marco Coyle. Please welcome Ross Bryant, everybody.
Yes, hello, father. Thank you for telling me I'm a good boy.
I am the golden father, and you are the golden son.
all I live for is to be the ye golden child.
Yes, you have achieved it. You are the chosen one. How are you, Ross?
I'm doing good. I'm doing some remodeling in the office here. It's, you know, these are the excitements that one has under lockdown.
Yes, we are still under lockdown, and now I will never return to society. It's too late for me.
Yeah.
You feel the same way?
This is the only kind of socializing I'm comfortable doing anymore. If someone's not in a tiny box on my screen, I become frightened and shrink into myself.
Man, shrinking into myself is something I do all the time, especially when my naked body hits cold water. Ross, pretty Marco Coyle, very briefly, talk about where he's at. We don't have to get into the weeds of his stats right now, but how's he feeling after that last score?
He's feeling pretty bad, I gotta say. Things ended rough. Everything went to hell in a handbasket. And if memory serves, the whole gang spent a good portion of the end of that session getting tortured by the authorities. So he's been having his mortal soul rent from his body again and again and again. So let's just say he's stressed.
Yes. Well, hopefully he will have some opportunities to relieve that stress and find the next big job that'll make it all worth it, right? Because that next score, Marco, that's just, yeah. You just need that next score, and then your life will be, it'll be easy street.
Yeah. Good life's just a score away.
You'll be living in White Crown, you know. Everything will be great once you just get that next score. Speaking of a man who loves to score, he is a member of the Glass Cannon Network. He's a fantastic game master and player. This still describes both of them. But this guy just interviewed me on Cannon Fodder. Was that yesterday? Good Lord. Time moves slowly or quickly in pandemic. He's such a pleasure to play with because, unlike me, he knows the rules. As the spider and mastermind, Archibald Gray, please welcome Joe O'Brien, everybody.
Oh, hello, Jared.
Hey.
Catching up on the rules, buddy.
There you go. Thank you for doing that. One of us has to.
Somebody around here has to.
Yeah, exactly.
What's up,
man? It ain't going to be me, brother. It ain't going to be me.
Yeah. No,
I just love Ross's style, man. Ross just like shows up. It's like, just tell me what you need. Tell me what you need. And then home run. Just tell me what you need. Crush it.
How many dice do I roll?
That's the improviser's, you know, bag. You know, they don't have to bring anything to the show. They don't, you know, you create it when you get there.
Right. This is the source of the simmering resentment between improvisers and stand-ups. Where, oh, you have your material, so you actually have something that's not ethereal, that is not a laurel you can rest on.
Yeah. Well, I actually quit theater and moved to stand-up because I was sick of having to, like, you know, be put on costumes and, you know, know how to put on makeup and remember lines and all of that stuff. Archibald Gray, how's he doing?
Well, relatively speaking, he's doing great compared to, I mean, I feel like they walk out of this ghostly, horrific, soul-wrenching interrogation, and he's looking at Marco and Murmur, and he's just like, oh my gosh, like, what are we gonna do as a crew? This is so bad. But he managed to resist some of that harm, and he is middle of the road, stressed. He's got some lingering spiritual burn, but otherwise, he's good to go. He's just got his sights on moving forward, and managing our heat, which I feel like we have problems coming. So
yeah,
his concern is the crew right now, not himself. He thinks he feels fine.
Yeah, you said that you did the math as well. I can't wait to get into the heat with you because, I mean, I'm feeling warm right now.
But I know. I was reading it, Jared, and I literally was like, oh my God. Oh my God.
Yeah. We created some heat last time. I say we because I was right there in it with you. Let's bring in a man who took a lot of the heat. He took a gut shot during the score. His character did, rather. He is also an incredible entertainer, podcaster, game master, and player. And we are honored to have him here on the Stream of Blood playing Pontiac Zoe, the Tycho Rossi former sex worker, now slide with mesmeric powers. Please welcome Troy Lavallee, everybody.
Hey!
Kaboom!
Yeah. Aaron, Ross, and Joe, my once a month buddies.
Welcome back, buddies. Once guys. A month is not enough.
It really
once
isn't.
A month buddies. Yeah.
This needs to be a bi-weekly.
Can you imagine twice God. Every week?
God, an embarrassment of riches.
Right now, my Discord is filling with people going, Troy promised it was bi-weekly now. I have a child, everybody. We all have children. And Ross has a dog.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Pontiac. Pontiac, oh, I hinted one of the things that happened to him. How are we feeling about Pontiac? We were talking a little bit about it before we started here.
This guy is a disaster. And this afternoon, I was like, when my son took a nap, I was like, I'm going to sit down and really see what I can do here. And I was like, I think I'm going to be fine. And then for the 15 minutes before we started the show, we were chatting. And I was like, oh, I'm worse than not fine. Like, this is so bad. And I'm interested. I don't even want to talk about it because it's so much is going to be decided about the future of Pontiac Zoe. Tonight live.
Yeah. Yeah. We were sitting here beforehand and I feel like you were kind of like, I think he'll be okay. And Joe was just sitting here going, he's fucking dead, dude. I think he's wiped out, bro.
Your hose, bud.
Which if you watch our shows, I sort of have a reputation for being a little more like, stop complaining. Like, you're fine. You're going to be fine. You know, it looks bad, but you're going to be fine. And here was the flip of the coin. I was just like, where is this positivity coming from? It's misplaced. Murmur's in a bad spot.
Yeah, it's not
well,
good.
I want to, before we start into all this, and we are going to do that right now, I just want to thank this crew for being so open to putting themselves out there, risking themselves, and letting me enact all the tiny, terrible little tortures I'd cooked up for them, letting them inflict those on them. You guys are incredibly good sports and incredibly good players, and I have no doubt that you will make it out of this pickle that you find yourselves in. But right now, will you say, let's play some Blades in the Dark?
I love it. Right. I love it. You know what? I just want to jump in and say one thing and kick the praise back to you because there is something I read in this book. I can't find the exact page, but it's around this section where you deal with downtime and stuff. And it just explains how crews and the people that make them up are such a mess of history and responsibilities and debts owed and all that kind of stuff that like they don't just drop in and together and work together to do a score like you see with kind of other role-playing games. This is like, and what you've done, Jared, is I'm thinking about it as we're looking into these characters and what my character's at, is I feel like I have so much pressure of personal nature, like people that I owe, things that I have to deal with that are outside of what our crew does, that I want to push the crew to do stuff that helps me specifically. I've just never played a game like that. And you do a great job of weaving that so that the pressure we each individually feel is on completely different things, but drives us as a crew to what we choose to do, which is awesome.
Thank you. This is a really great game to game master. You don't have to prep too much to run a session, but you do have to keep a lot of plates spinning all the time. Mm-hmm. So it uses your game mastering brain in a different kind of way. A different kind of way than this canned intro I've prepared 1,000 years ago. This was a land of beauty and magic. Then came the cataclysm that blotted out the sun and ripped open the gates to the land of the dead. The city of Duskfall is a metropolis of factories and refineries, protected by its crackling lightning towers, fueled by marvelous electroplasm. Outside the walls is a wasteland of vengeful spirits. Inside the walls is a wretched hive of scum and villainy, intrigue and corruption. Life is cheap in a city ruled by death. The sun is gone. The only thing that shines in Duskfall are the blades in the dark. See how I put the title right at the end?
Yeah.
Guys, it's time to talk downtime. And so let's begin the way we always begin in downtime with XP.
Yes.
Did we all mark our desperate actions last time? Each of those is worth a point of XP.
I was very desperate. I had 5 desperate actions.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah. But unfortunately, I went into the session saying I'm going to make every desperate action I can in insight-related skills, and I didn't. It didn't happen based on what we were doing, so I was just putting XP in things that I was already good at. I need to put a point in insight because it screws up my resistance rolls and whatnot.
Yeah.
Anyways, but it's just not happening. It's just not Pontiac's
It screws up your stress relief too.
Yeah, it's terrible.
Yeah.
Massively.
But I got 3 XP in resolve and 2 in prowess going to the night. So if I earn some other XP, I think I might be going up in one of those.
It's wild. So Pontiac has a bit of a weakness, and it's in his kind of insight area. I also think it makes total sense that he, you know, took 5 desperate actions because this was kind of his job. This was kind of his score with his backstory involved. So it meant a lot to him, and it took a heavy toll. It took a heavy toll. Just while we're talking about it, he's also taken. We'll get to that in a second. How about Marco Coyle? Any desperate actions for him?
After that incredible feat of desperation from Pontiac, I don't think Pretty had any. It was all consortium with the House of Ill Repute that we were attempting to take over, and none of those were particularly desperate. And even though Marco Coyle did commit a bit of murder last time, it was in a very controlled they'd scoped it out and made it less than desperate when it actually went off. So
that's right.
So I think as stressed as he is, as much of a wreck as Pretty Marco is, despite, I got to reiterate, his absolutely gorgeous face. Yeah. He doesn't have a lot of XP to grow on, it looks like.
That's okay, because you know the other XP triggers here kind of always sort of make sure you get something. How about Archibald? Was he desperate in any way? It just helps us recap a little bit.
Yeah, I think so, and only once I had down. I felt my memory of it was that it was a desperate action to attempt to command the spirit wardens.
Yeah, I remember that.
So I did that. And other than that, I don't remember. I actually felt a little bit controlled. I feel like I got some XP in some other areas, but I listened back to the episode and I did feel a little bit like I'm not playing my trauma very well, to be honest, because I have a reckless trauma and I have done it in the past, but that situation, I felt so compelled to like keep things under control, because immediately Murmur got things out of control because of the mesmerism of that one sex worker who like pulled out a gun and was like, I'll kill for you. Like, and that got out of control. Marco got wasted on trans powder right out of the gate. And I was like, all right, like no room for recklessness here. But that's just poor play, I think, on my part. So I got to keep that in mind. I keep that recklessness in mind.
Absolutely. So, I mean, if you haven't seen our last session, go back and watch and leave a comment. Tell us what you thought. But regardless, I mean, like, I just want to like briefly say the crew tried to take over a series of brothels, two brothels owned by Pontiac's rival Nyrix, whom they murdered and then kind of waltzed in and were like, we're the new management. They had a lot of good kind of approaches to kind of convincing people that they were the new management. But as you have heard from our players, things got out of hand. Playbook specific triggers. Pontiac, did you hit your trigger?
Hit my trigger like...
Yeah, the slide has a playbook specific trigger. So yeah, I'm just seeing if... I bet that you did.
I think I did too, but... playbook specific.
Yeah, that, here like, we go.
I used mesmerism.
Is that what that means? Yeah, your playbook specific trigger is you addressed a challenge with deception or influence. I would say yes, right?
Yes. I'm wondering if I did it twice.
I think that the trigger only goes off once. I don't. Okay. I could be wrong, and if I'm incorrect, chat or. Anybody who would like to, please correct me, but I think that it pops off once. You can't just like keep popping it off.
There's this one line right above it that made me wonder if I can get at least two. When you say at the end of each session, you get mark one XP if you did it once, or two XP if it occurred multiple times. But I can't remember if I did it more. I feel like I've just lied every session we play together. That's all I do.
You know what? I think that you may have. So I'll go ahead and give you two for that, especially because
like
you're hurting.
That's good.
You're hurting. I'll give you two for that. And then did you express your beliefs, drives, heritage, or background? Well, it was all about Taikorosi people last time. So yeah, I take one for that.
Okay.
And then, you struggled with issues from your vice or traumas during the session. What do you think of that? I mean, now you're definitely struggling with them now.
My current traumas, we'll get to my new trauma in a second, are haunted and unstable. I think it's fair to say that his whole encounter with the sex worker upstairs really showed both of those things on display. He's still messed up from his run-in with that woman he mesmerized on the
Margaret
boat.
Margaret Vale.
And like that was coming through in his interaction with the sex worker. And then the instability was just all of his desperate actions. So I would jockey for 1 point there if you feel
Then you shall have it. So right now I'm tracking you at 8 XP from the last session. Good Lord. That's a big old haul. How about
you were a bit of a star last session?
Yeah, you were really swinging for it.
It was a Murmur episode.
Yeah, you were the Gladys Knight, we were the Pips.
On a special Murmur episode of Blood and Glass.
On the next Murmur.
Murmur. Okay. Coming to the CW.
So you definitely addressed
right after One Tree Hill.
Yes, Marco, you addressed a challenge with violence. You threw Nyrix off of a roof.
I dropped a person off a roof.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. What about your beliefs, heritage, or background?
Heritage, background. I don't know that factored in, but I didn't encounter any Dagger Isles folk.
You know what did factor in? Did you struggle with issues from your vice or trauma? Marco,
sir,
got,
I certainly did.
Marco,
I got high as hell.
Too high during the score.
I got too high to score. So yeah, Marco's vice is stupor. So yeah, he got powdered up but good and was borderline useless. But he was trying to be a coercive party boy and show the sex workers there that this was the life of wine and roses they were going to have if they came along for the ride with the tin whistles.
Sure he was. Yeah, that was his only motivation.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm cracking him at like 2 XP right now. He only addressed that one thing with violence, right? I don't think he did it more. He didn't get violent really more than once, I don't believe.
He killed him at the top, and then at the end he just kind of ran up to see what the hubbub was. And was holding Pontiac together when the spirit wardens kicked down the door.
Yeah, that sounds right. Okay, and then finally, Archibald Gray, calculation or conspiracy. I mean, I have to definitely give you that. You know what? I'll give you that twice because, you know, you're the one that kind of scoped out Nyrix before she was tossed off a roof, like to figure out when to go after her. But you're also the guy who, I mean, talk about a conspiracy. Don't go upstairs. My friends are about to be in a gunfight. Let me talk you out of going upstairs, Mr. Spirit Warden.
I think the real conspiracy one was the flashback that was like where I acquired that arcane powder that burned all of the evidence of our names in her files and stuff like that.
Yes.
Talk about juicy conspiracy.
Well, then let's call it that 3 times you did.
Well, no, I think it's 2. I think it maxes at 2 XP.
Let's call it 2 then, if that's if that's the rule. Let's see, express your beliefs, heritage, or background.
I think so. And I'll pitch for one here.
The court will hear your explanation.
Thank you, Your Honor. I believe that, so he's got two beliefs, belief and drive, I think that came up, which was his not doing drugs. He's very kind of freaked out about doing drugs and was adamant to not do them, even when things were getting hot and heavy. And remember, he got saved by the bell, which I had forgotten, like you made a consequence that he had to do it. And it was like, right. And he was just about to, and right at that time, the gunshot went off. But he was trying to keep his head about him for all of this calculation and conspiracy stuff. But then on the drive's end of things, as we were planning this whole thing, he was adamant that they not be blamed for the murder because he wants to keep the operation kind of clean. Because of his ambitions in horse racing. Like, he doesn't want to have a name as a known criminal. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, he could be feared a little bit. He's got something shady going on. We don't know what. But he's very adamant that he doesn't want to be stupid about his criminal enterprise, and he wants to keep it as clean as possible on the outside. So to me, that seemed like his drives. I'm arguing for one there, but you do.
I'll give it to you. So, we're looking at 2 from the specific spider trigger. We're looking at 1 from desperate actions. That's 3, and then I'll give you the I'll give you that one for 4, and then I don't know if his vice or trauma came into it.
No.
Okay, great. All right, so I think that's it for everybody. So right now I have Pontiac at 8, Marco at 2, Archibald at 4. Let me know if that pops you up to like a new tier where you can get like a new special ability or something.
Dude, if you got 8, I mean, just
looks like 8 does.
Looks like you might be able to.
Everything in insight that you didn't do desperate action. So like the.
Here's the thing. I could be wrong, but I think the XP you earn during the score for specific tracks stays there, and
sure.
Then post session XP is the only one you can put wherever you want.
Oh, because you only have 3 post session XP.
Yeah.
Gotcha. So the playbook XP always goes in that little playbook counter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
So what I'm gonna do is just I'm gonna max out my resolve and put a point in a tune. It's not something I'm super interested in, but I think it's after what happened during the score, their run-in with the spirit wardens,
yeah.
I think it has touched him in a way where he is now more interested in the other side.
Oh, it's so necessary too. Like I'm realizing more and more that this really is a definitive part of the setting. It seemed obvious at first, but now it's like, it really is. It affects everything. And who knows, like there is no way to know if like Nyrix's ghost couldn't like come and haunt us and stuff like that. You know what I mean? So having a tune is going to be important, I think.
It is going to be important. You know, it's a ghost world. I mean, I kind of like that you guys are so specced for like crime, you know, as opposed to like some of the weirdness. I think that this city definitely has people who, you know, deal with the reality, you know, the concrete realities of this place a little more. But I think it is very smart to just protect yourself, to have a little bit of a tune so you can handle it when that weirdness crops up. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Also, I'm sorry. That's your first point in a tune, right?
Yes.
Don't underestimate the importance of adding another pip to an attribute because of resisting harm. And this would come into play in harm that is like mental harm. So like, or spirit harm. So like resolve, you'll get another die to resist harm.
Yeah, I have
harm.
Three. I'll really have good. Three die in resolve now because I have 2 points in consort and 2 points in sway. So that's my bread and butter. I'm doing fine with prowess. I don't have a single pip in insight. I'm a disaster.
So Clint, make a note that we should only attack the tin whistles with insight related harm.
And tough but fair.
This guy's gonna study you to death.
Let's go into the crew XP quickly, and if Mr. Clinton Trust can throw up that tin whistle smuggler sheet.
Oh, here it comes.
Did they execute a smuggling operation? They did not. This was not a smuggling operation. Did they contend with challenges above their station? They sure did. Go ahead and give them one for that. Did they bolster the crew's reputation or develop a new one? They sure did. Let's give them an XP for that. We're looking at the XP, my friend, right under, I think right under smugglers. Yeah, okay. And did they express the goals, drives, or inner nature of the crew? I have to say absolutely, because this was really tied into Pontiac's backstory and his, you know, the things he owes to people who, you know, Clem helped him out of a tough spot in his life. I mean, that's, if that doesn't reflect the inner, and it was so ambitious too, which is your reputation. Mm-hmm. I mean, we are gonna just kill the madam and then walk in and say we're the new bosses.
Maybe that is the time.
It's a hostile takeover.
It was great. It was great, and it was definitely ambitious. So you get XP for that. So before we get into how much this earned you, and that's a little complicated, I would love to just throw up our factions for the city right now and see kind of how the Tin Whistles stand in terms of how they relate to all the other groups in Duskfall. So here we go. Let's see how close we can get to that.
I've never seen this.
This is amazing.
Yeah, we decided. So now that we're doing a faction turn with all of our subscribers, and if you subscribe to the Stream of Blood, of course, you can be a part of that and help to control one of the factions of the city that interact with our player crews all the time when we have our player games. So we know that the Tin Whistles have some status with a couple of groups. One of which is now the Spirit Wardens, right? Oh, okay. First of all, let's talk about the Foghounds. And your previous score, you all but wiped out the Foghounds, but there's one member left. And I'm saying that that means that that crew still technically exists. They've lost their turf to you. They've lost their ship to you. And so you have a -2 reputation with them, outright hostility with them.
That's Bear, right?
That's Bear.
Bear is the one who got away.
Right below them,
you'll see the Lost. The Lost is a crew that is, I think, about at the same tier as you. They are a gang of sort of anti-corporate guerrillas. They're kind of like beggars and sex workers and people that live at the very bottom rung of society who believe it is their job to help other people that are in their position. They're a bit of a Robin Hood gang of thieves. They probably have a -1 with you, which, Clint, remind me, what is -1 kind of in what's the connotation of -1?
-1 is just interfering.
Interfering.
They're not going to go out of their way, but you know, if they can keep, if you're in there, they'll kick you if they have to step over you. How about that?
Yes. And now that interfering status arised from an entanglement role that you made during one of your downtimes. Mm-hmm. These people will still help you sometimes as well, but they're just in your way all the time. Like, and one of the reasons they are is you both have hideouts in the same like old abandoned rail yard. They're like on the other side of the rail yard, and maybe a lot of it is just close quarters, but the physicker you've been using to kind of heal you up, he is a member of the Lost. And then I think there's only one more. Is it the Spirit Wardens is the only other group that they have negative status with or some kind of status with? You guys should start building positive status.
Aren't we cool with the vampire crew?
Ah,
yeah, we.
I feel like we were cool. It was like, all right, you take the bodies. We'll see you.
Yeah, we should talk about that.
Yeah, Lord
Spirit Strangford. Spirit wardens, you have -1. We know why they are interfering, but you did convince them that you were not the murderers. That you are not. You are beneath their notice for now, and so they are merely interfering. It looks like you guys occasionally leave a body behind, and you saw how difficult they made that. The blue coats are always at a -1 for anybody who's in a criminal gang because they're the police. But I hear you on Lord Strangford, and we've had a lot of conversation about this during the faction turn. Clint, is city council on there? Or can we write in? Can we write in factions? If we can write in factions, let's write in Strangford and give them a +1.
City council is here. So Strangford is an interesting case, in that he is the head of the Leviathan Hunters and a member of the city council, mm-hmm. and was conflated with Lord Skurlock, who is his own faction, which we may want to clarify now.
This is the best.
No, we're not going to clarify it now. We're going to continue to let it kind of reveal itself. For right now, these guys should have a positive status with Lord Strangford. So why don't we just make it Lord Strangford?
How about Leviathan Hunters? Because that's awesome.
Pretty great.
By the way,
if that's
on
what
my
the players
list.
Think, let's give them a +1 with the Leviathan Hunters.
Because that is somewhere where we could legit do work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like smuggling operations
and you have a boat.
Stuff. Yeah.
Leviathan Hunters +1. There it is, baby. Beautiful. So in terms of Lord Strangford, that is where you will be able to interact or kind of, gain like sort of push pull with him. Like, and it makes sense. You guys did a smuggling operation at sea. This is kind of how you know him. This is kind of how you'll contact him. Okay. Is through the Leviathan Hunters. All right.
Hey, Jared.
Yes, sir.
Just because we have so many new people joining us for this particular session, let's make mention that we do a faction turn once a month in which subscribers to the channel are assigned to various factions and will get to choose what progress clocks are moved forward for each of these factions. Awesome. And one of them got filled in the last faction turn to at least one crew's detriment. We'll see how that goes.
Jones? Yeah.
God.
Don't give things away. You're the secret game master, goddammit. Okay. Keep a secret. All right. Let's talk about payout. Yes, guys, of course, if you subscribe to the channel, as I mentioned earlier, you can join us for that. Okay, payout. You guys seized one of two vice dens belonging to Nyrex. So I'm going to give you the benefit of seizing that claim. And maybe we could even, Clint, if you don't mind, bring up the crew sheet and show that we have now seized that claim, which is the Vice Den. Here is how the Vice Den works for you guys. You get, from now on, during downtime, you can roll a number of dice equal to your tier. You get coin equal to the highest result minus your heat. So I'm going to allow you to have that. You now have this sort of income coming in. You'll always roll your tier. Yeah, there we go. Yes, tier roll minus heat equals the amount of coin you earn in downtime. But because, and I am open to negotiating this, gentlemen, but because you failed to seize both of Nyrex's brothels, I'm going to rule that this is your only payout for the job. The small vice den on Skid Row and Night Market turns a profit for you, but you didn't get accesses to Nyrex's entire savings or all of her resources because you did not take down the other brothel, the Arms of the Marchesa. So let's not forget that you must also pay your tithe to the boss of Coleridge, who we have decided is Ulf Ironborn.
Two questions. One, wouldn't that give us a reputation with Ulf? Shouldn't we have a +1 with someone if we're paying them every score?
That's fair. I don't know that you would have a +1 with someone who takes money from
It'd
you.
Be a zero.
It might zero. Be a zero. Yeah. So now, zero. If you don't pay him, it might be a -1. And if you help him make more money, it might be a +1. But right now, you're at neutral. with gotcha. Ulf.
And then second question, you're saying we got no coin from the
I'm
last
saying score, you so got you'll get the coin based on this Vice Den roll, but that's it.
But that will be zero, won't it?
Well, it might be because and look, yeah. I know I'm putting the screws on, but I think that this is pretty fair. I'm allowing you to seize the claim, but I'm not like giving you also extra coin. Is yeah, basically no, what I'm doing.
I'm just trying to wrap my head around the mechanics. I think it's a guaranteed zero, isn't it?
Well, let's see. I mean, what is our current tier? What is our current tier for?
One.
It is a tier one. Tier so one. We're rolling one die. You're going to have to take your heat away from whatever you roll.
Mm-hmm.
And let's talk about heat, yeah, let's guys.
See what the heat is.
Let's talk yeah. about we have heat to from the last from, score.
You know, since we went your up the clink.
Is the heat on?
The heat is on. It's on the street.
Did you say it's on the streets?
It's on the street.
Oh.
The H
heat.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Last time was
whoa.
The heat was high because you came under the watchful eye of the spirit wardens. I'm going to say because you did convince them not to yes, we were at tier one. Because you did convince them not to think of you as the murderers that you know, after that long interrogation and thanks to Archibald's manipulations, you kind of removed all evidence of yourself from the books. I'm going to say that it was a contained level of heat. So that's plus two heat. Okay. Mm-hmm. Then did the score involve killing? It did. Plus two heat.
Oh, maybe we'll just be wanted with no heat.
Oh, actually. Yeah. So we could make money out of this, but we just get a wanted level. Interesting. Yeah. I didn't yes. think about that.
Oh, I didn't think about that either. It looks yeah. like you, I'm giving you one more heat though. And I want you to know why. You get plus one heat if you're at war with another faction. I think that when you cut Nyrix's turf in two and took over one side of it, you have gone to war with the rest of Nyrix's gang. Right. I think that's fair to say.
I don't think it is because that's a player choice, like going to war because like. I believe because it changes a lot of the mechanics, especially of downtime.
Really?
It's a status of like downtime. It isn't just like having an enemy. Like if you're going to war, I know you can only do one downtime activity instead of two. And there are other repercussions too. And I'll read up on them. But I'm like, I'm happy to do it. Cause it's also kind of like, if it's forced upon us, then we don't have a choice. But I don't. I just want to make sure that you know that going to war is different than just having like an enemy.
Yeah. Well done. Because I think I thought that you know, it makes sense to me that this other side of that group would be really pissed at you and gunning to get their Vice Den back. Like. In a hard and meaningful way,
mm-hmm.
But I guess I didn't realize that going to war meant that there were a bunch of ramifications for the rules.
Yeah, a tin blanket on the chat was just like, "May I approach the bench, Esquire Brian? You may approach the bench."
Speaking of the chat, and while we're clarifying, the chat has pointed out that previously we had risen them from tier zero to tier one rather than giving them a special ability. So I think they should still be tier zero, but they're supposed to have an additional special ability.
I think that sounds
is that
right.
accurate?
Okay. I just thought that because we've never filled our rep meter.
That's correct.
Oh, okay.
So you're owed a special ability.
I do have a vague memory.
You should still
of that.
Be tier zero.
Okay. Wow, that's a giant curveball. I was gonna resolve the war thing first. Let's see.
There's so much going on.
Yeah, there's so much happening.
Do the war thing, and we'll come back to this.
No, let's talk about it. So the rep meter hasn't filled. Is what we're saying?
Correct.
Okay. You know what? How much rep do you get for a score? Like, you know.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Can just are there like four total tiers of all gangs in the game? So like if you're tier four,
there's actually five, you can go up to five.
If there's only five, I think it makes sense that we're not yet tier one. I mean, we've only done three jobs. So I think it makes sense. If it went up to like 10, I'd be like, I think we should be at tier one at this point, right?
Right. That makes sense. All right. Well,
all right. Man.
Tick it back. Tick them back down to zero, Clint. Tick them back down to zero. And let's we'll choose a new special ability instead.
Oh, okay? Some of these are great.
All right. It feels like we're losing ground even on the character sheet. All right, let's take a look at.
So if we don't roll any tier dice, does this mean we don't get pay?
Well, you'll roll two and take the lower of the two. Yeah,
right.
Great.
When you have zero. That's what
taking you're a freaking pay cut. All right.
So let's take a look at these. Yeah. Can we make the sheet a little bigger, my friend, so that people can see a little more clearly? Thank you. Okay, so all hands during downtime, one of your cohorts may perform a downtime activity. Ghost passage, you may become immune to possession by spirits. Just passing through during downtime, take -1 heat. That might be useful to you. Mm-hmm. When your heat is 4 or less, you get +1 die to deceive people. Leverage. Your crew supplies contraband for other factions. Your success is good for them. Whenever you gain rep, you gain +1 rep. That's huge.
Great.
And Reavers. When you go into conflict aboard a vehicle, you gain +1 effect for vehicle damage and speed. Interesting. Renegades. Each PC may add +1 action rating to finesse, prowl, or skirmish. Up to a max rating of 3. And then when you are a veteran, you can choose from other crews.
Wow.
I'm looking up rep a little bit. But do any of those sound good to you guys?
Renegade is the total min-max way to go.
Yeah. And that's actually the area where I'm trying to level right now is prowess, which is so funny.
Yeah.
Yeah, why couldn't it be insight? Why?
Why?
Stymied every turn.
I think Reavers is interesting. It's not min-maxy, but as smugglers, I feel like there are times like we're going to have to focus on doing some smuggling jobs, and there are going to be vehicle situations. So that's kind of interesting.
My argument for just passing through is we seem to be a risky crew that is going to draw a lot of attention. If there's anything we can do to reduce the inevitable heat, it might be the right choice for our ambitious crew.
Yeah. Take big risks, keep low profile.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Not my favorite.
I'm down. Well, look, while we're talking about it and thinking, let me just lay out war real quick, because you can look at those repercussions and see if that affects your choices at all. So war means that if you go to war, this other faction will hurt you even if it's not in their best interest to do so. So it's like a fanatical. They come after you no matter what. They expect you to do the same. When you're at war with a faction, you get +1 heat from all scores. You temporarily lose 1 hold, which would mean like we need to lose the vice den or fleet temporarily.
Wow.
And the PCs only get 1 downtime action rather than 2. So I knew I read this and I was like something. I was like, war is never good. So I was trying to avoid it at all costs.
It's actually quite bad. I think that let's handle it this way instead. Let's handle it this way. We're going to say only 4 heat because you're not at war. You're not at war with them. But I am going to create a new faction. I'm going to create a new faction on the faction meter called, you know, Nyrex's Dens of Iniquity or whatever. And we're going to give you a -2 with them. They are outright hostile to you. And that is how an enemy should be kind of, handled. They might start making moves against you. And then when you see what the results of that is, that's when you guys can decide whether or not to go to war.
I like that distinction between hostile and war in that they'll do it even if it's not in their best interest to do so.
Right. You know, they might wait. They might buy their time. They might come up with a great plan to screw you guys over.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So let's write in, you know, Nyrex's gang or whatever and give them a -2 with that group. What's a -3 secret game master Clinton
war.
Trucks?
That's war.
That's war. Oh, just -2 then. Let's just go -2. They are hostile.
Cool.
Let me ask you something, Jared. My at character creation, I chose my sly friends, and you choose one that's positive relationship and one that's a negative relationship. Nyrex was my negative relationship, and now she's gone.
Yes.
Do you want to add someone in that is a new negative relationship?
I want you to add someone in. And it can be someone we've met before if you'd like. Mm-hmm. Or if you'd like, I can like just introduce somebody and that can be who it is.
Bear.
Bear.
It could be. It really could be. Nyrex's Dens of Iniquity, negative two. Thank you so much, Clinton Trucks.
Oh, look at that.
Perfect. Okay, so good Lord, where were we? Okay, so we have resolved how much heat you have. Yes. We have not chosen a new special ability for your crew or given you your rep. You should earn 4 rep for that last score, actually. So you're almost, I think. You're almost full. 3, 4. Yeah, you need one more, and then you will have. I think it's that you have to like get a stronger hold on things that you have a weak hold on. Oh, but you're already strong because you start strong in Blades in the Dark. So yes, one more rep will earn you tier one. And here's something interesting, guys. One of the special abilities that you're due gives you extra rep in leverage. Certain situations. Yeah, leverage. So I think that we could look at that one, and that if you are really interested in becoming tier one right now, that could bump you up to tier one, or you could pick one of the other ones and say the next score will do that for us.
Okay. And we would be tier one with a weak hold, right?
That is correct. Yes, yeah. You'd be tier one with a weak hold.
So yeah, there's always a weird balance.
I like leverage there because you roll on your tier so much during downtime, and this isn't just a short-term goal. Like, that is the gift that keeps on giving. Every score is an additional rep that we do. So we're just going to hit two faster. I'd go leverage or the obvious PC boosting one. But, you know, the other thing is these PCs might not always be around in this crew. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, it makes sense to put stuff into. Oh, wait, does any new PC that comes in gain that benefit? Maybe that's how
I think that that's how I would rule it.
Yeah, it makes sense.
Well, guys, it's time to choose, and it will affect, you know, if you take leverage, it will bump you all the way up. Let me make sure.
Actually, Secret GM Clint says you also have to spend 8 coin to raise a tier. So you have to have the rep and then spend the cashola.
So they want to make it like, so John Harper wants to make it not easy to bump up in rep. I mean, in tier. So, okay, we hear you on that. I think you guys do have 8 coin. You currently have, it looks like, 10 coin.
Okay.
Then whatever you earn from this tier minus heat roll, which will be, let's face it, as Joe said, will be 0. So
we didn't hit the wanted level?
Oh, that's right, the wanted level. Okay, so you get 4 heat. Let's do this. Let's bring up the crew sheet again.
Wow.
And we're going to add the heat, which is up to 4. Okay, great. So you'll take a wanted level 1, and then you'll go back down to 0 heat. Okay, great. So now the money you gain from the Vice Den for this last score will be a simple disadvantaged roll, to use a common gaming term. You'll roll 2 dice, and you'll take the lower of the 2, but you'll earn that much coin. You won't be subtracting any heat from it.
That's great.
So who would like to make that roll right now and find out what our payout was?
I'll make that roll. 2d6, okay. Take the lower.
That's right.
Come on. Go for it. Boxcars. 5 and a 6.
Wow. Yes. That's really good. My man.
5 coin. 5 coin from the brothel that you have taken control of. Well, you guys are going to have you're going to really have a lot of money coming in now from this Vice Den. That's kind of awesome.
There we go. Yeah.
So let's go ahead. And now the coin vault is really, really full. Look how big it is. So the thing is, you really could take that leverage power now.
Yeah.
Then you could go up a tier, and then you could pay to go up the tier, or you could take a different power. Let's decide that now. What is the new special ability of the crew?
Let's do it.
Ross, where's your head at?
You never say anything. You just sit there judging us.
Never. Yeah. I'm just I wouldn't do that, but seems weird. No, I think I'm the muscle, man. I'm not here to think. I also don't have the book in front of me. So this is kind of my first gloss on all of these.
Yeah.
So, honestly, between the three, I'm like, all these sound fine to me. I'm, gain one rep. I'm kind of down to, if people are leaning leverage, I'm fine for that. But I think if I'm playing in character as Marco, then, having an advantage in a vehicle fight, where he can be particularly vicious, sounds about right.
Yeah. I think the Reaver thing fits Marco perfectly. But yeah, I mean, I'm just going leverage again, because with that coin that we have, seeing how hard it is to get to tier one, we should get to tier one. It affects so many roles.
Leverage, yeah.
It affects our, what's the first role in a score?
The engagement role.
If you're going up against a tier one, you know, we wouldn't be at a disadvantage anymore. Larger Duskwall world that Blood and Blades is running, I think that would make us the top crew right now.
Make you the top crew right now.
Come on.
Oh, okay. No question.
And don't worry, I'll make sure to mention to the other players in the other games. Like, and one of the crews is way ahead. Yes, let's go. So it sounds like people are agreeing on leverage. So
paint that target on us, Jared.
I didn't know I was going to do this, but here's what happens. Okay, you gain plus one rep, right? Per score. So since you should have already gotten that special ability, we bumped you up a tier, but we actually should have given you a special ability. That means you already got that rep. You got that rep before. So that means you go ahead and bump up to tier one, right? There we go. Put baby at tier one. There she blows. But you now have a weak hold on the places that you hold. It makes sense. But here's one more thing I'm going to do for you. The special ability specifically states that you provide contraband to a group, right? I mean, and that is why you have more rep, and that is why you are kind of important to that group. I'm going to say the guy that you pay your tithe to, Ulf Ironborn, that should also confer you a plus one status with him. So I'm going to go ahead and give you a plus one status with Ulf Ironborn, the guy you pay a tithe to, because you're letting him use the brothel for free.
And look, if he needs something, you know, he might come to us for it. You know what I mean? Like, I think that there's a certain amount of
trust. He's a good friend to have, especially where we now have a weaker hold on our turf. If we run into some problems, we just call up old Elf. Maybe we call in a favor and he takes care of it.
For real, though, I mean, think about it. We go to him. We're like, if we don't have this turf, we're going to have a really hard time paying you. We're going to have a hard time completing scores. He's going to be like, I'll take care of it.
We're business partners. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. He can go off and have the adventure while you guys kind of hang back, you know?
Wouldn't that be nice for us? Yeah.
Yeah. Can we just pay the Ironborn and the whatchamacallit, the hunter, the, I forget what they're called, the Leviathan hunters to just do scores for us? And then we can just do downtime every episode. Yeah.
Just so you know, your wanted level is now one. So if you get caught by the blue coats, which is a consequence I could levy against you in certain specific circumstances, you would go in for a month or two. You can also, I think, sometimes choose to kind of get caught or whatever and go in for a little while. You will make an incarceration roll. And when you're in there, that is also a tier per die roll. So it's probably a good idea to be as high tier as you can before someone goes into prison. Let's do our entanglements. All right. So this time your heat was your heat's down to zero again. That's good for you. Someone needs to make a roll for me, and we'll see how entangled you get. I believe this is just a 1d6. Let me make sure. Yeah, I think it is. Let me make sure.
But, yeah, you roll a number of dice equal to your wanted level and use the result to select which sort of entanglements manifest.
That's it. Okay, so a wanted level of one. Someone needs to roll a d6 for me. And we're going to find out what your entanglements are, the things that are affecting your crew during this downtime.
Yeah, this is a cool mechanic because as you get more wanted, your entanglements go up,
Right. You know what I mean? Life gets harder and more complex. Yeah.
All right. I got a dice here.
All right.
Die. 5.
Okay. So your heat is 0 to 3 right now. You're 5. That means I have a choice here, and I'm going to make it with a random die roll as well. Okay. The choice is that the little ghost girl that you brought back into the city after your first heist will not leave you alone. So you are constantly being awoken in your hideout, like by like things falling off shelves. When you are like, you know, riding in the city, or you're kind of like walking in a place where you have to kind of pay attention, she suddenly jumps out in front of you and you almost like fall off a bridge to your doom. Like she is constantly like appearing and throwing you off. And what that means for you is that I can kind of throw her into other situations, but I want you to know that it is an ongoing situation, and that if you want to get rid of her, you need to acquire the services of a whisper or a railjack by using the acquire asset downtime activity. Because right now, she could really screw up your next score. She could even fuck up your downtime activities. Like, you know, ruining the deal you're trying to make in the vice den to get your stupor vice filled. I'm letting you know that danger is out there. And that is the unquiet dead entanglement that you have earned there. But now we come to the game part of downtime.
I just wanted to mention for those that haven't seen earlier episodes or whatever, this ghost girl, we made a deal with her that we would bring her back into the city if she would help us with a heist that we had in our first score, and it worked, and she helped us, and we had to sneak her into the city, but now she's coming back to the palace. This is so cool.
Yes, so she's appearing a lot, jumping out in front of you, making you almost like hurt yourself. She is waking you up, not giving you any sleep. This isn't just doing downtime activities right now. This is also a little bit free play. So if people want to investigate any of the threads that we've mentioned in all of this bookkeeping, like, for example, you're like, we took a long time to, and we should have, and it was good, to figure out that this other group is hostile to you. If one of you wants to say, hey, I want to look into that, that sounds like a huge problem for us, you are welcome to do that, and I'm not going to count it as a downtime activity unless it starts to sound like it becomes acquiring an asset, healing, indulging a vice, or doing a long-term project, right? So those are when I'm going to activate those downtime activities. So we can just start with the downtime activities, but if at some point you guys want to kind of morph it into free play and start making moves toward your next score, you let me know. But for now, let's begin, because I think we do have to touch on this again. I think Pontiac Zoe should be the first person that we talk to about downtime activities. Because Pontiac was shot, and then his soul was tortured, and he still has electrostatic burns from that first smuggling operation where you went out into the Deathlands and you met that ghost girl, and the electroplasm splashed onto you. So he's in a bad place. He's got 3 harms. Talk to me, Pontiac. What is Pontiac doing in the aftermath of being tortured by the Spirit Wardens? What's his next move?
Yeah, so he ended last session unconscious. He maxed out his stress and passed out. So the good news is I start my downtime with all that stress cleared. The bad news is that I now end up with a third trauma. And at 4 traumas, you're done. Your character is gone from the game, or at least from the active part of the game. I was already haunted and unstable. So I have taken on, just to torture myself, reckless as my third trauma. I feel like this brush with death, this brush with the spirit world, this mesmerism gone too far has now made him almost seek death. Wow. Yeah. So I think that's the way he's going to play out.
His mesmerism has gone sort of horribly wrong twice now. And partly it was because of the devil's bargain mechanic in the game. But also he's just so good at mesmerism. It's sort of, it has almost too much of an effect on his victims sometimes.
Yeah. And he gets lost in it too. I mean, that's the way we've kind of played it. Really, it should be a skill that he uses like an X-Man. But he gets lost in this because of his, I think where his pleasure is such a part of his background and it's his main vice. When he's mesmerizing a subject that he might be attracted in, he's getting lost in that. And so now he's caught between, driving the car and being in the backseat.
The recklessness may, is a direct side effect of that. It's sort of like his mind is sort of torn in different directions. Sometimes, you know, in the past, he's even thought he was the person he was mesmerizing for a short amount of time. So his mind has taken, there's been a real toll taken on his mental faculties. What does he want to do for his first downtime activity? Of course, every character gets two, but you can spend coin to purchase more. And some people have special abilities that give them more as well.
So this is the thing that I read today that I don't know if it's come up or not, but if you don't indulge your vice, mm-hmm. you take stress equal to your trauma. Mm-hmm. So if I only have two activities and I don't indulge my vice as one of them, I will take three stress because I have three trauma. Here's the thing. If I indulge my vice, we did the math. This is what we figured out before we went live. If I indulge my vice, I will automatically overindulge. And if I overindulge, the ramifications, there are some options. One, we can attract trouble. So we already have this entanglement with the ghost girl. It would be an additional entanglement. Maybe not too bad. We're already a disaster of a crew. I could go around bragging about my exploits and gain +2 heat. It just doesn't seem right. It doesn't seem right based
on
all.
It also doesn't seem right for the character.
Yeah, no, it's just that's not his way.
Yeah.
Lost, your character just vanishes for a few weeks. Gets lost like in the bowels of the whorehouses around town. And then the fourth one is tapped. Your current purveyor cuts you off. Find a new source for your vice.
And that doesn't make as much sense either because you've kind of taken over the vice den that provides your vice, which is pleasure. So lost seems to make sense. And then what's the first one again? It's
attract trouble, get another entanglement. So,
I mean, that feels like that makes sense as well. But it does feel like he has to. I mean, he kind of has to indulge his vice, unless you want to take that three stress. But he's hurting so much already. It means he'll start the next score with three stress. What do you think?
I think rather than hurt the crew, I'm going to take the stress.
Okay.
Because he feels responsible in a way for some of the desperate moves that he made. Some succeeded, some failed during the last score. So rather than bring another entanglement to the crew, he is going to take the three stress.
Okay.
I was all excited to have zero, and now I'm so close to that fourth trauma, but that's what I'm going to go
with. Which will take Pontiac completely out of the game. Mm. So having made that sacrifice and taken that stress, maybe your crewmates do realize that you're just not in a good place. You're still stressed and your brain is still addled. You're behaving recklessly. Crewmates, I think that it's fair to say you noticed this about Pontiac, but he's still in it. He's still looking for the next big score. But right now, what downtime activity would he like to engage in?
I'm going to take an XP in insight. I feel like he is how that plays out, not mechanically, but in the role playing world, it's like he realizes that he's losing his grip on reality. So he's trying to spend some time like in doing mindfulness activities, mindfulness exercise, just trying to get like a grip back on reality. So that's how I'm manifesting that +1 XP in insight.
Okay. So that is spent, that's That's not acquiring an asset.
Well, yeah, what activity is that?
Yeah, what activity is that? Because you guys have training, but you have training only in prowess. You do not have training in insight as one of your...
Oh, you can't... You can just... I thought you could just mark one XP in any attribute.
One XP if you have the appropriate crew upgrade.
Yep, the crew training upgrade, which you guys do not. You only have prowess unlocked. So he could train himself in prowess, but not...
I thought you got an additional one if you had that crew ability. I must have read it wrong. I still meditate.
it still happens.
But yeah, then I will take it in prowess because I'm so close to getting another a couple more desperate actions, and then I will. I'll still train in prowess. And so, what am I actually doing?
What are you
training montage
doing? I can tell you. Let's see, prowess covers finessing, prowling, skirmishing, and wrecking. These are physical things, so I think I want to hear Troy's description of what Pontiac's doing.
He's just like swinging from fire escapes,
on fire. Doing parkour through the city.
Just doing flips and rolling into hiding behind trash cans and jumping out and scaring people on the way to the theater.
Well, possibly Pretty Marco is teaching him some of these things a little bit, like knife. He just survived getting shot. And you remember there were a couple times on the score where Pontiac was kind of needed to roll skirmish, and he just doesn't know how to do those things. So maybe that would make him ask Marco to kind of teach him the way of the knife a little bit.
It could be that, like, in the back of the the rail car, in the back of the brothel, it's like I'm wrapping your fists up in rags, and like, come on, let's see what you got, boy. Oh, yeah, there we go. And just like flipping around and like just like pat, doing your little katas.
If this is the montage early on, I'm like really crappy at it, and you're just like shaking your head.
Yeah, yeah.
At the end, I'm like,
"Good lost cause." Cut to Pretty Marco, like, "That's a boy."
Yeah. Well, at one point, I think that what happens in a lot of training montages when the student like suddenly gets frustrated and is like, "Ah!" Like, and just starts like beating like crazily on you and like screaming, "I'll kill them for you, Pontiac!" Because he momentarily snaps into the personality of the last person he mesmerized.
I like that. Yeah, and it also builds the relationship with Pontiac and Pretty a little bit more. So that's what I'll do.
Yeah. Great. I mean, it's also really, really hilarious for him to just be jumping along the rooftops like Batman. But I think that we should say that it was your good friend, Pretty Marco, who trained you. And so we will move on. Think about what your next downtime activity might be, Pontiac. But let's now talk to Archibald, the jockey. What is the jockey going to choose as his first downtime activity for this downtime phase?
I'll start out by trying to relieve some stress.
With your vice.
So, yeah, with my vice. So I'm going to go to the track. He's sitting at 5 stress. Mm-hmm. So there's some concern there. He can't go into the next score with that, in my opinion. So he's going to try to visit his old buddy Lucius at the track.
Great.
And throw a little coin on the ponies.
All right. You get to the track, the smell of it, and it's not a pleasant smell, but to you it is. Mm-hmm. It's just like when Marco dabs a little bit of the Black Lotus. For you, the smell of that track, that horse dung, that dirt, it just like it invigorates you. And the sound of people shouting, the bookmakers kind of shouting. So it is time for you to roll your weakest attribute rating.
Okay.
And then you will clear stress as a result. So what is your weakest attribute rating?
Weakest is prowess, as we were discussing. You have me saying it prowess. Is it prowess? Prowess. Anyway.
Oh, it's prowess. I mean, no, I'm from West Virginia, and that is the explanation for that. By the way, I will continue to say prowess. That's how I say it.
I like prowess.
Okay. So, my friend, you may roll your
prowess.
Okay, come on. Yeah. Basically, I'm trying to avoid a six here. A six is terrible, and I'll take just about anything else.
You'll overindulge if you hit a six.
I freaking rolled a five.
Yeah.
So, perfect.
All of my stress wiped away. Amazing. Nice.
That's not the only thing that happens.
It's not?
But first of all, you, you know what? First of all, you win one coin. Let's
ooh,
add one
nice.
I mean, nice. if you hit it perfectly, I can't not give you some other kind of benefit, right?
Pretty sweet.
And then I'm going to give you this as well. While you are kind of like collecting your winnings, one of the noblemen who you know to be sort of owners who have access to that sort of private bar at the track, you can see that he's kind of eyeing you and smiling at you.
All right, so he's got this nice suit on. He's a legitimate member of society. He belongs
That's right.
with these mm-hmm. people. So he'll notice him looking at him, and he'll just give him a nod and then walk over. And
Mr. Gray.
I don't believe I've had the... no, I'm sorry. I'm trying to do like a fancy accent. I don't believe I've had the pleasure, mate. What's your name?
We have had the pleasure. We met in the private club here at Char Hollow Downs. Caius Rhodes. Caius Rhodes.
Right.
I would describe this guy as the Acarosi version of... forgive me, Ben Shapiro. Like, he's like a little man, and he's a little slick, and you immediately kind of don't like him, to be frank with you. There's something kind of, and all of these guys
slimy.
Have given you,
yeah,
he's something slimy about him, but also, like, these guys have given you such a hard time trying to break into this world, because you come from a different social strata. Anyway, he says, I wondered if we might meet outside the track briefly to discuss an important business opportunity for you.
Well, of course, whatever you say. Name the time and place, I'll be there.
Very good. My valet will call on you with my social itinerary, and perhaps we can arrange something this week.
Later, but if you indeed decide to go to the meeting, you are in a very fine dining establishment, and I gotta be honest, it's like in White Crown. So, Archibald, you have probably rarely eaten at a place like this. Don't let me put words in your mouth, but I think rarely.
No, rarely. And, but this is where he wants to be. Like,
exactly.
This is where he has seen people go from the racetrack off in the distance, and he's like, I want to go there.
Right. So Caius starts, he takes it, they give you tiny utensils to open up this tiny little bird that they've put in front of you. And keep in mind, like, this is Duskfall, where there isn't the normal livestock we had in our world. There is so they're probably, like, you know, somehow in a lab creating these, like, tiny birds. And they're these tiny little utensils you use. And he, succulent. I understand that you are an associate of Lucius Dabbs.
Oh, right. Well, we all know Lucius, right? See him every day at the track, every day I can anyway.
Well, yes.
Why?
No, we all know Lucius, but you are friends with him.
Well, we've gotten close over the years. I've placed a lot of bets, you know.
Yes. Yes, well, do you know this new chap that he's running around with, this Iruvian fellow, Sethla?
Yes, I do. I have met him once. I was at the track, and he was speaking with Lucius on an unrelated matter. It had nothing to do with horse racing, I felt. So, but yeah, I've seen him before. Why?
A chemist, is he?
That's right.
He sips his wine. A pharmacist.
That's what I've heard, yeah.
You're looking to become an owner eventually, are you not, Mr. Gray?
Aren't we all? I mean, that's why we're here, is it not? It's the price.
It's not just a matter of having enough to own your own horse. It's more than that. You have to be accepted by the other owners. You know, it's a fraternity, a brotherhood.
Yes, of course, yeah.
And that brotherhood greatly appreciates fairness. The integrity of the sport. We work very hard training our horses and creating beasts that can do miraculous things. It's really like sculpting a creature out of clay when you breed an animal for many years. It's like creating a beautiful statue. And so I ask you, Mr. Gray, because you have access to some information sources that myself and the rest of this fraternity do not have. Is there any doubt in your mind as to the fairness of the operation that Mr. Dabbs is running?
Well, let me ask you a question, Caius. If I felt like there was some skullduggery going on at the track, particularly with this pharmacist, I assume it's safe to say that something will happen to this fellow and his operation was to be cut off. Safe to say my name wouldn't be mentioned, right?
Why, I have many different information sources, and you are a fairly new friend. I think that would be safe to say.
No, I agree. I think that it should be a level playing field, and I don't like juicing the horses there. If that's simple enough for you.
Juicing the horses? How? How are they doing it?
Well, that I don't know. Well, I should say, it will cost a lot to find out. Then he goes back to eating.
I'm going to have another one of these birds.
Hello.
Two more. No, you can order them like this. It's how they do it over there in Scoveland. Yes, two more. Thank you. Coin, if, you say.
Mm-hmm. If the details of this operation were to be discovered, I might know someone that could get on the inside there. What would that be worth to you and your other owners?
Well, it's really about the integrity of the sport, you understand.
Oh, of course.
The integrity of our organization. To start one coin until we found that these accusations had merit. But there could be an ongoing relationship after that, and of course there would be the undying gratitude of the fraternity of horse breeders.
You gotta see Jared smile. I mean, if you're just listening to this, it's amazing. He's such a dirtbag. He just says you've got a deal. I'll get you the methods used by this particular cheat. I'll take a coin and maybe we can keep talking.
I'm going to end the scene there, but he smiles really big again. And you may add two coin to the tin whistle sheet. One for what one for what Archibald won.
For gambling winnings.
For the gambling winnings, and then one for his information.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to leave Archibald there for the moment, and we're going to move on to the muscle, but also the heart, Pretty Marco. What would you like for your first downtime? Oh, God. What would you like for your first downtime?
Because I feel like I've neglected that Pretty Marco now has two trauma, which I realize I never specified what was the other trauma in addition to Vicious that he picked up.
Yeah.
And I looked it back over the previous session, and I think the most apt thing I can say is unstable.
Okay.
And I think that perhaps his time in undergoing interrogation has made him even more so.
So
vicious instability, just the sort of person you want watching your back.
Well, I can tell you this, pretty Marco, since you're kind of mentioning his situation where he was kind of interrogated for a long time. He did remember the name of one of the people that was torturing his soul the entire time. They actually dropped it accidentally, but that main warden that came in that Archibald talked to for a long time was named Baccaros. Baccaros. And you will never forget the things that Baccaros did to you. Oh dear, I've popped a fuse.
I thought you were doing it for like
incredibly atmospheric. Yeah.
Yeah. Right at the right moment.
Yeah, well, we'll be fine. I can keep running the game, obviously, but I'll have my wife reset it. But in the meantime, let's keep talking. So,
just have her light a gas lamp behind you, or an oil lamp for the atmosphere. Just a
nice hissing gaslight, and Okay, so never forget the name, never forget the face, never forget the things what he done to me. Marco's just racking up vendettas because we haven't touched on the whole ox back. We haven't touched on the whole ox back scenario either. The guys that attacked his friends from the Dagger Isles, he hasn't touched base with them for a second. But they were rivals.
So I think
to the
that you worked on that long term project in your first downtime, but did you work on it in your second one? I don't know that you did.
No, because then as now, I'm super duper stressed, and I'm even more so now. Marco has 8 stress, so if he has one more, he too will take a third trauma. So I think it's time for him to maybe try to decompress.
Yeah. Does he want to go back to that vice den down by the docks where he had the Black Lotus the first time?
Ah, geez. Now stop me if this is like maybe stretching the definition of stupor, but he spent weeks like tied up and having his feeling his like essence like ripped out of him. It's such a feeling of like physical and spiritual impotence and helplessness. It's that like the helplessness of like an animal in a laboratory cage. And so he's in a way he doesn't want the like takeaway. It's more like I want to feel it all. And so I think is there one of my dangerous friends is a pugilist. And I think maybe while I'm training Pontiac, I think maybe I'd like to just like it's like as he's like whacking my hands occasionally, I'll just let him down. I'm just like, come on, do me in. That's right, boyo. Bam, stole the old bean in. He's like, boss me good, you prick.
I'm looking over the possible vices, and I think that works. Like, because the vices are faith, gambling, luxury, obligation, pleasure, stupor, and weird. I mean, what else would getting the shit kicked out of you in like fighting matches fit into other than stupor?
Can I say that to relieve stupor, I maybe enter a prize fight?
You may say that. You may say that. And so, in fact, I think you enter like several. Like you kind of take yourself through the like little circuit while you're in your downtime. Boy, what a great way to have downtime, which is to just go into underground fighting kumite rings. And you may pick your lowest attribute, rating, and then you can roll, and we will see. How much stress are you at right now?
8.
Okay.
So I have one pip in insight. So I guess I just roll the one die.
Okay.
And I roll a 1.
Ah.
Oh. Oh. God.
Come on.
OK,
Okay, you cleared it to
help
7.
Help him on these rolls if we wanted to, right? Don't you?
Maybe, maybe.
I don't know if you can help on a vice.
You can spend coin to make it a 3-4 or a 4-5. You can spend one coin to make it a 4-5.
On page 159. On page 159, add +1 D to your roll if a friend or contact helps you with downtime activity. I don't know if we're considered friends or contact.
No, it's like I think it's a bold friend and bold contact. I think
but
it's
wait,
it's like
he did kind. Say that he was talking to his contact, Marlene, yeah. A prize fighter, right?
There That's you great. Go. That's
Marlene, come
roll
on.
Another die.
Come on, Marlene. Friend. We'll see what she did.
Great.
Set this all up. She, you know, she's putting him up against people that it makes sense for him to fight, but he's telling her, I want to get hurt. And she's like, okay, Marco, if that's what you want. And so
maybe it's like before these matches, cracking some ampules of something under Marco's nose to like really get some blood up. And here we go. Okay. That's more like it. 4.
There you go. Half of your stress is now gone. Oh, nicely done.
Awesome.
And that's really, really exciting. You get a little information from Marlene while you are doing all of this. First of all, you couldn't feel better, but your face is like like a black eye. I can't believe that happened again. And, you know, it's just like a swollen wreck.
I would say that pretty Marco is still like, even though he's trying to get hurt, an homage to his vanity is like wrapping up his face in like the crudest version of like the most steampunky version of a face mask. But he's still plenty fucked up.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. Oh, I forgot that he's pretty. Wow. I can't believe I narrated that. This probably is shows like what a strange headspace he's in.
So it's like he's like looking in the mirror and like this side is like gorgeous, but over here it's like a mangled mass of blue and yellow bruises and a totally like veins burst eye.
Yeah. Great.
Can we pause for a second just to think about how different these two characters are, Archie and Pretty Marco, like what they're doing when they're not on the score together. It's like the wildly different parts of society. It's so great.
Yeah.
Maybe let's say that even like Marco wears it well. It looks great somehow.
What I will tell you is that Marlene does tell you something while you are engaging in all this. She actually has you fight several members of Ulf Ironborn's gang. Now, this is all for sport, so nobody, you know, it's not taken personally or anything. It wouldn't affect your faction status with Ulf Ironborn. But what Marlene tells you, and I'm just throwing this out there. This is just a detail, okay? And you could leverage this later in some way, or maybe you just remember it, or maybe it gives you an idea for a score. But basically, Ulf Ironborn's gang will never back down from a fight, even one they're definitely going to lose. So what you learn about Ulf Ironborn and his cohort is that they accept every challenge. And that is just something you learn during your indulgence of your vice. Let's leave Pretty Marco with his face kind of
like plunging my face into a bucket of cold water, like whipping it up and looking in the mirror, and the little girl is there just like
yes, she is. And I will say this, like
fucking right.
When she appears to you this time, Pretty Marco, she's in the mirror and she's like in the doorway and she's like this, and then she runs out the door.
Oh.
And I follow.
Very good. You don't see her in, you know, the room that you're in, but you look outside the window and you see her, you know, she couldn't have traveled this fast except that she is a restless spirit. You see her kind of like standing on like a hill of garbage out in the old train yard, like staring at you. And she's like,
and it's like wringing the water off his hair and just like walks off towards her. Cause normally she's just like popping out. This is an actual interaction. He's walking.
Are you following her?
Yeah.
We'll leave you following her because I'm going to tell you that she
she makes you follow her across the city, and eventually you get to the bridge to Dunslow, and you're like, what am I doing here? I thought I was back at the fucking hideout. Like, you know, you still feel a little dizzy from the fighting. And then you see a wagon going across the bridge out to Dunslow, and you see her like sitting on the back, like smiling at you. Meanwhile, Pontiac Zoe, what would you like your next downtime activity to be?
I have given this a lot of thought, and it's kind of wild, and it's going to take two parts. So the first part is, I would say around our, what is our lair? Are we hanging out mostly on the boat together, or do you think now that we have acquired this vice den, we're spending a significant amount of time there together?
That's a great question. I assume the rail car for Pretty Marco right now, maybe right. Each of you has a place you can stay now. If it's okay with Pretty Marco, maybe he kind of likes the rail car still. And, you know, maybe you hang out in the vice den.
Okay. So I'll say I'm over at the rail car finishing up another training session with Pretty. And, you know, I grab my side because I still have that bullet wound that I'm nursing. And I'm obviously a little jumpy from the spirit torture. I've still got burns on my arms. And then I look at Marco, and Marco's beat up as well. And I think I should try and acquire us a physica that will work for us all the time. We should have our own doc. I feel like we're going to be getting into a lot more sticky situations, and we're going to need someone that works for us exclusively.
That makes sense. And I believe acquiring something permanently like that is a little bit more of a task. Well, acquiring an asset.
Acquiring assets sounds like it's temporary. I think this would be a long-term project. And I was wondering, just to connect it to the world that you've created, trying to lure that doctor from the other faction to come be with us.
Oh, you're going to try to get the physiker Reed from the Lost to come over to your gang.
Right, and just, you know, under the auspices of like you're on a dying ship, the tin whistles are where it's at. Come work for us. You know, we also have the business that we're in. We might have people that will need treatment from time to time. Like, he's going to have plenty of work, and plenty of work means plenty of coin.
So here's how I can characterize this for you. One of two ways. There's the temporary asset acquiring, which is kind of a roll of your tier, and then you just see, you know, what you get, but it's temporary, right? You don't have him forever.
Right.
Or you could do a long-term project, and for this, because you're targeting Reed, who is a lower tier than you now, mm-hmm. I would say it would only be a 4-wedge clock to try to get him to come over, because he spent time with you in the past. It's probably hard to be a member of the Lost. He knows he can depend on your coin. I would say that it is possible, you know, for you to kind of to pull him over in 4 segments if you wanted to do it as a long-term project. I'm trying to think if there's another way to acquire an asset. And there is one other way, which is that your crew, when they get upgrades, can grab like cohorts, and a cohort is either a gang, like a bunch of dudes that, you know, beat people up for you and guard for you, or an asset. But that's gonna have to wait until the crew acquires, I believe, you know, more XP.
So we have one of those. We should have a cohort marked off on there. We have a gang on the boat. We have a few, like,
let's bring up the sheet. Clinton Trucks, do you mind throwing up the crew sheet?
While you're doing that, Clint, I just want to mention, Troy, that I don't think that this makes a ton of sense, because of his tier, because essentially we can, now that we're like a tier one, like we can get him to work for us every time for just a role. I guess it is an activity, I think
we still have to spend the downtime activity to
you always
acquire
have
the
to.
Asset. And then somebody has to roll. I'd spend another activity to heal.
To
I want a permanent guy. And so if I do a long-term project, I could roll.
But what I'm saying is, all I'm saying
critical,
is,
I could get him right now, for example.
Yeah, I'm just saying, if we're going to do a long-term project to acquire one, we might want a better doctor because he's tier zero.
No,
is all I'm saying. Like, but I think
if he comes over to us, I wonder if he'll immediately get bounced up to our tier. I don't know how the mechanic.
Yeah, works. Yeah, and I guess that does he the might, tier. Right? Yeah, does a physicker of a certain tier like heal more? Like, is that how it works? I actually don't know.
That's actually sort of how it works. I mean, a physicker of a certain tier, I think they roll their tier when they do their healing, and that will totally affect how much harm they are able to remove. Yeah, I mean,
I like the long-term project idea.
So yeah, I know I like it, and it doesn't. It looks like it doesn't matter what their tier is. It's if they're on the crew, because it just basically becomes. They do a tinker role. It is. It's a physical special ability, the quality level of the NPC. So a zero is he rolls twice and takes the lower result. But if he comes over to us and becomes one, then he would roll one die. On a 1 to 3, he heals one segment on your healing clock. On a 4 to 5, 2 segments.
Yeah, okay. We'll never have to worry about the acquire asset for a physicker again once I complete this project. The doc will be on our team. And but I kind of like the
tier
idea.
One?
What's that?
But does he become tier one when he comes over? If not,
I'll rule on that. As the game master, I will rule that he becomes tier one. I mean, if he joins a tier one group, then he is tier one. You guys can buy him, you know, better supplies. This is part of how you're probably luring him over, right?
Right.
So I'm going to rule that. And yeah.
He now has a clean bone saw.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Well, I think last time we said he was using like herbs that he like pulled. Well, actually, I'm sorry. Duskvol doesn't have normal plants. Anyway, he was before the chat goes nuts. He was not using herbs, but he was using suffice to say lower grade ingredients in the different medicines and things that he was creating for you. So let's go ahead and let's set up a 4 segment clock for you. My friend,
and this is Pontiac. Great. I roll like consort, I think, or maybe no sway.
You can choose, I believe, yeah, right?
I'll say sway as I'm trying to sweet talk him. Like, why? It seems like an easy sway. I'm explaining, like, I know you probably have your loyalties with that crew, but the tin whistles are on the up and up. There'll be plenty of business for you, and work begets more work. I think to me it's a no-brainer, but I don't want to tell you your business. And he winces and grabs his side.
Very good. He seems intrigued. I mean, let's see how much he holds to his principles, because you guys are a crew that's out for coin, and his people are sort of like, we have principles. And that's kind of what he's telling you right now. You need to understand that redemption is possible if we look within ourselves, and then you make your roll.
All right. Boxcars, and I'll get them right now. Otherwise, how about just a good roll? All right. I got a 6 and a 4. So 3 segments.
3 segments out of 4.
Great.
He's almost yours. I'm going to leave it with him saying, look, I'll think about it. You're using those meditation techniques I showed you?
Yes, they've been rather helpful, but they don't heal bullet wounds to the stomach.
No, I understand. I'll meditate on it. You'll hear from me soon, Pontiac.
Good, good. Take your time, and you know, if I'm not around, someone else will be in touch. He leaves that out there and then leaves.
He heads back across the rail yard. He heads back across the rail yard to his abandoned rail car on the other side of the rail yard. And then we come over to Archibald Gray. Archibald Gray, what is your second downtime activity?
Well, now I'm all screwed up. So would you rather, I'll put this to the crew, would you rather that he, okay, you know what? I'll take a break and do a little role play.
Okay, great.
Archibald is going to just reckless, but bold and confident. He is just going to walk into the other vice den. the nice one, the swanky one.
The arms of the Marchesa.
Mm-hmm. The arms of the Marchesa. With the intent that he just wants to talk to whoever's in charge.
Very good.
Who's picking up, you know, the business over there, basically.
So the arms of the Marchesa is sort of a middle, middle level inn that caters to, the burgeoning middle class of Duskfall, out of town travelers. So people from like White Hollow and the other rail connected cities on this little continent. And when you walk in, it's a front. So there is a desk clerk and he's like, checking in, sir.
Sorry, I just can't. It's so good. I think that Archibald would know who's kind of like running things there now, if it's been, a week or something. Like,
he is a spider. He is a mastermind.
He'd probably get a name.
He knows where they have their meetings, which is, he has to climb the stairs up to, the plaza suite of this place, the big kind of like luxury, the one luxury room they have at the top. Does he just brush past the desk?
Yeah, he just walks by, like taps his hand on the desk. And he's like, I'm all taken care of, mate. It's all right. Already got my meeting set. And he just like walks up the stairs, like super confident, doesn't slow down. He's got his swanky suit, his nice polished shoes, and he just goes up the stairs.
He comes to, the third floor landing. The other landings had, halls of doors, but this one just has one door. It does have a brass plate that says Nyrix Arquetel, owner proprietor. Of course, they're gonna have to change that.
Mm-hmm.
Do you knock or walk in?
He'll knock.
The door opens, and you're looking at like another like Taika Rossi kind of like sex worker. She's dressed provocatively. And she's like, hello?
Yeah, I'm looking for who's in charge here. I've seen that the door's a bit out of date. Wrong name outside.
She steps back, and you can look into the room. And it's all one big level with beautiful windows that look out on the different catwalks of Night Market. front and center, there is a... madam, a new madam, perhaps. Looks mm-hmm. like a Taika Rossi who has now put on like more lavish garments. She has two male Severosi security guards with her, and there's someone else with her. Archibald Gray. Bear stands up. And when he sees your face, he smiles. And he starts moving toward you. And we are now in free play. You wanted to role play instead of just do downtime activities. So,
did you bring anyone?
No, he just went solo. He
you
was
sure?
like,
you sure?
He's reckless. I was trying to be more reckless.
You were reckless, all right. Bear's coming toward you right now. He was having a meeting with your new enemy. It makes sense. And now mm-hmm. he is going to retaliate against you. I'm just gonna go ahead and say I'm supposed to telegraph the danger and let you roll actions. This is gonna work a little bit like a score until you resolve the scene. We may resolve it in less rolls than we would normally resolve a scene, right? We might do like one, two, or three to find out what happens to Archibald Gray right now. But right now Bear is just charging at you.
Charging at me.
Yes, you're in the doorway to this sort of penthouse suite here at the Arms of the Marchesa. And he basically, when he sees you, he smiles really big. He knocks over the entire table to get it out of his way. The madam or whoever he's talking to tries to pull him back, and he's just charging at you as he pulls a big, ugly knife from his belt, still smiling and laughing as he charges at you. Archibald Gray, what action will you take?
He is going to... Well, geez, if we're moving it to score, then...
It's not a score necessarily. It's what we call free play, which means you can make action rolls, but we won't count it as a score exactly.
So I can't say I have like a loadout or anything like that.
I think that we have to allow you some something, right?
You know what? I think the first thing he's going to do is, because he did not go in here with the intention of violence, he's going to try to avoid it however possible. He's a very small target. Bear is coming at him, large and in charge. I'm going to try to do a finesse roll to kind of martial arts him, like use his own head of steam to hurt him. So just kind of like move at the last second and run him into a wall or something like that and just make him look stupid. By like dodging out of the way.
So I'm going to call this a desperate action, and what I'm going to say is that if you fail this roll, you are taking harm. He is going to stab you. He is going to try to cut your throat, basically. So that's how high the stakes are. All of a sudden, in the middle of our downtime. Yes, I'm allowed to change it up like that. I know everyone's brain is melting. The other detail is that your action will have a standard effect because you do have a chance here to finesse. You know, you. I mean, that's a good choice for you, I think. And Archibald thinks quickly on his feet, as we have seen before. His feet, such as they are, I think he has a bit of a limp. Here we go. Make your finesse roll.
I am going to spend stress to push the roll.
That's a good idea.
I'm going to add another die, so I'll take two stress. So I have two die to try to get a success here.
Devil's bargain.
Well, I thought about it.
I can offer one.
Oh, yeah. Why don't you offer it? Why don't you offer it? Let's hear what we got.
All right.
I don't want to get stabbed.
Look, my devil's bargain is... I'll let you have an extra die right now, but if you fail this, if you get a consequence or you fail, you don't get another downtime activity in this downtime session. You get captured or held up for the rest of this downtime by this encounter. Handling this encounter.
Okay. All right. I'll take it. I had two more things I was going to do downtime wise, but I'll give them up to try to not get stabbed.
Okay, that makes sense. So you get an extra die, but keep in mind, I said if there's a consequence or a full failure, downtime activities are gone. You need a success.
You need a pure success. All right, I got three die. Oh, I never saw this coming. Bear, bearing down on him. Come on, Archibald, dodge out of the way. I rolled two ones.
No!
Two ones and a two.
Oh my God, Archie, no!
Here's what happens. Bear grabs you. He shoves his knife into your gut and goes, "How does that feel, you fucking traitor?" And then when he's done doing, do you want to resist that? You can resist that, or you're going to take the level two. You want to resist it?
Yes.
Okay, great. I'm going to say that he's toying with you more than that. Then he doesn't, if you resist it, he doesn't quite, or maybe you have like some kind of protection on it, doesn't quite go as deep as he thinks. And then he's like, "You fucking piece of shit, traitor. You fucking hurt Marget. Now you got to hurt, you fucking cripple." And he throws you down the stairs and you go boom, 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 like all the way down the stairs of the arms of the Marchesa, which are quite steep. And when you land at the bottom, you are surrounded by Severosi security, Tycherosi sex workers, Bear and the new madam standing over you. Archibald, you have been captured. But wait, you need to give me that resistance roll. I want to see how much stress you took to resist that consequence.
First, I would like to have armor on, like under my suit, like a leather, because he knew he was going into a possible dangerous situation. He didn't want to make the first move, but I want to say he had some armor on.
Okay.
Which I don't remember what it does right now. I can't remember. I'm freaking out.
Your special armor just allows you, without rolling and taking stress, to just resist a consequence. And so I think that's what he has done.
Or maybe it lowers it by one or something. Okay, so he doesn't take as much damage from the stab. Yeah. Yeah, if that's cool with you. Otherwise, I can roll to resist. I don't know.
It's cool with me. I mean, it makes sense that he would have some kind of loadout. And there are special armor rules specifically for this. So I think that sounds completely completely within the bounds of what we've been talking about. Let me see here. Yeah, armor. Reduce he could have taken that as part of a loadout.
I think it may reduce harm by one. So a level 2 harm becomes a level 1 harm.
That sounds right. Okay, let's do that instead. So if he's going to use the armor, then he gets a level 1 harm cut instead of stabbed. We'll call him cut.
I'm sorry, Troy. Where are you seeing that? Because I see armor allows you to mark off the armor and avoid a consequence instead
that's
of rolling.
Special armor, and then there's regular armor, right, guys?
I'm just seeing armor. If you have a type of armor that applies to the situation, I don't know. I just felt like stabbing was pretty standard.
Yeah, you that's can, pretty standard.
You can mark an armor box to avoid. Either way, you know what? We could work that out later, whether it's a level 1 or a 0. But the effect is still happening. He still falls down the steps and gets freaking surrounded by all these people, regardless of the harm.
He's captured. I mean, is captured.
Reducing the consequence is reducing the harm in this case. You know what I mean?
Does it reduce it to nothing or
no,
to...
No, just by one step. Like, if you read the example, Silas is taking level 2 harm, cut to the ribs. He decides to use his armor to reduce the harm, so the harm becomes level 1 bruised instead of cut to the ribs.
It says resistance. You reduce or avoid the effects of a consequence GM chooses.
In that case, I would say that it makes sense to me. If you're using the armor instead of taking the resistance roll, then I'm going to say you're cut.
So it's
a level 1 harm.
Gut cut.
Yeah, your gut has been cut. Ugh. And you are captured as well. Holy shit.
Jesus. Oh, no.
And what a shit ass devil's bargain I gave you too, and you took it. You idiot.
Oh, I rolled 2 ones and a 2.
I know. You could have made it. You could have made it, but you
just rolled it again. I rolled a 6.
We are going to allow, we're going to watch as Archibald is pulled up by the Severosa security and Bear comes up. And this isn't more consequences. It's just the scene. Bear just is beating in the middle of like the beautiful, like they're actually like business travelers coming in and then walking out again. Bear is just beating on you in the middle of the lobby of this mid-level inn. And then we are going to jump to Pretty Marco Coyle. Pretty Marco Coyle, I want to role play with you for a little bit.
Okay.
Finally see the Dunslow is out where the prison is, and it's a weird sector of Duskvol because it's kind of industrial, but it's more like it's kind of the outskirts. There are like the weird kind of farms that they use are out here. It's kind of the boonies for Duskvol. And this little girl has, this ghost girl has brought you on a chase all the way out here. Then you see her go into like a large tunnel that is kind of like, it looks like it's like a water drainage tunnel or something like that. Cause you're out here in this sort of like the no man's land, like kind of like runoff section of the city.
She's leading me into a pipe.
She's leading you into a large pipe.
Okay. Marco, with this like bandage bulge. It's just like, what's your game there, sister? Followed you halfway across town, but you must think I'm pretty dim if I'm going to follow you down there. What sort of beasts you got waiting for me? Huh? And maybe he's like just drawing near, but like seeing if he can gaze in. And can I say that he maybe like lights a match and...
You just hear like far down the tunnel a little girl's voice go, toys.
Get out of there.
Come play with me.
Go in the tube.
Play with you. Play with you. You must think I'm mad there, girl. And you must think I'm mad. And as he says that, he starts to walk in.
You walk through the dank muck and the water for like a long time until you finally see her like just kind of standing in the middle of a part where the tunnel, you've kind of you've left like the metal part of this like pipe. And you've kind of gone into a part where it looks like it's like a stone kind of aqueduct that somehow services Dunslow. And in this like kind of stone aqueduct, there's water flowing. It's like getting your boots all mucky with like the horrible detritus of Duskfall. But she's standing at this like kind of slight incline. And then she just like goes through the wall in this certain spot. And you can see that there's graffiti written in red on that wall. There is a strange kind of symbol. It looks a little bit like a star, but with like a goat's head. Superimposed on it.
Okay. Do I recognize the star and goat?
Always
a great combination. Marco puts that in his memory barge and it's like, hell of a place you found here. What? And he maybe like reaches out tentatively and touches the spot where she faded away. Look, there's unfinished business that'll keep it from popping up every time and dogging us from pillar to post. I wish you'd just plain tell us.
You notice that the aqueduct here, the infrastructure here, has been greatly damaged by the flow and lack of repairs for many years, and that this part of this stone that you've touched is kind of worn away a little bit, and with a little force you might be able to get this wall open.
So yeah, I'm does that how and this graffiti looks fresh or old?
It looks a little faded.
Okay. I mean this seems like an unstable thing to do for a person who's seeking pain. It's like you just pop up on us unawares, and you see, and Marco is like kind of putting on his spiked brass knuckles that he occasionally wears. Bid me to follow you all the way around town, huh? Popping through doors, grate me in the bleeding mirror. Well, maybe I can walk through a wall as well, huh?
When you finally a piece of the wall just falls away, and you're looking into the darkness, and do you still have your matches? Do you want to light one and look inside?
So it's just totally dark, and yeah, just a little. Yeah.
You find that someone has sealed up in the wall rows of what look like metal soldiers with strange, like kind of white porcelain kind of masked faces, and they are kind of all just standing there staring at you in the matchlight, and one of them which is kind of facing like this goes, and then you hear the little girl's laughter. We can end that scene there. I do need to know what your second and final downtime activity is.
You're talking to me?
That's right. We're going to end that scene there.
So he didn't die on the spot?
The creatures, the figures do not suddenly start moving and attack you. That's the last strange thing that happens, except for my lights going out for the fifth time. So that's the last strange thing that happens to you. What do you want to do when you get back? This is a hook. It's a job potentially that's out there. I guess what I would say is when Marco returns to his rail car, he realizes that those are hulls, which are these sort of golems that are used in Duskfall. They are inhabited by spirits sometimes, and are used as slave labor or weapons or workers.
Might be valuable to somebody.
Very valuable. You've just found a cachet of them, and it's the kind of thing that someone would need to smuggle, because you're not allowed to take them in or out of the city or give them to anybody you want. The government controls most of them.
Well, isn't that a pretty little thing? All right.
So I might tell Murmur if he's there. Got a line on some product to move, I do. If you got the right person to sell. I think he's maybe now that he's achieved some pain, maybe now's the time to have some old fashioned stupor and suck some of that sweet, sweet powder.
Oh, you're going to go to indulge your vice a second time in the vice den this time with the trance powder.
Yeah. Or I guess maybe unless there's a contact that I could think of, if this is one of the things that might be someone to fence or procure the toys I've just discovered.
I think that we can talk about that. If you want to acquire an asset, you can certainly do that. I would say you could also indulge your vice. Both are fine. If you are trying to figure out how to sell these things, then it would only ease your path to go ahead and acquire that asset. But it's also like, you know, maybe you could think of another way to handle it that would be sort of like a score. Like, where do you think the little girl wants those things to go?
Mm-hmm. My guess is she wants bodies for her and her family. So that might be interesting. I think it's vice time. It's Vice City.
Great. Then you know you roll your lowest rating, and we are going to see how much more stress you are able to relieve. And perhaps you tell Pontiac this entire story while in the throes of a trance powder haze. You have four more stress to clear. Is that right?
That's right.
And you don't want to roll over that.
Well, no need to worry, Jerry, because I rolled another one. Hey, it ain't nothing.
God.
I trans
well, powder. Well, in theory, an ally helped you do this. If you want to roll another die, an ally helped you do this. Pontiac and you own a vice den. You're using the trans powder that you were using last time with the Tycherosi.
Hey, I'll take that interpretation.
No, I'm just trying to get you to overindulge to create more horrible problems.
Maybe I should have. Okay. Wait, hold on. So
I say as I sit here in the dark.
So overindulge would mean if I rolled higher than my current stress level?
Yeah. That's right. And your current is 4.
No, it's 3 because I just took off one. So I just rolled a 4. Therefore, I just overindulged.
No. You would have been like rolling 2d6.
Understood. In that case, I'm just clear.
Oh, well, you're not only just clear, you're perfect, right? And we say that sometimes when you do that, I give you a little benefit of some sort. So the benefit would be that the trance powder is going to make your ability to plan or think of, you know, your possibilities right now. What? Oh, man, it's all so clear. You're seeing in other dimensions, man. Of course, that's when there's a knock at the door.
But it's all so simple. It's all so simple, don't you know? It was just fine. And I walk up to the door, and so the knock comes in, and I give our knock back.
Sure. Then you hear, hello, open the door.
I open it a crack and look out.
One of the other Tycherosi sex workers behind you, back in your vice den, goes, hello, Kara. And she's like, Sheik, hey, I have this for you. She hands you, Marco, a letter.
Oh, God.
And what's any writing on it?
Yeah, it says, we have Archibald.
What's it?
8 coin and release your hold on our vice den, or we will unleash the bear.
You're not that swell walking prick what stabbed me in the back. And I'm still, pupils fully dilated, turns to the sex worker that he's with, and is like, lucky for him, I'm feeling absolutely perfect. You know? And and just cracks his knuckles and walks out to intercept Pontiac.
I got something, Jared.
Yes.
If you go out to intercept Pontiac, Pontiac isn't there. Cut to the bridge where Pretty dropped Nyrex, that tall, was it a bridge or was it just like?
It was. It was like a bridge, but, it, you know, like a catwalk over Night Market.
So Pontiac's there and he's got an envelope in his hand. And he's just kind of walking up to that door where Nyrex was. And he leans down and he slips the envelope under the door. And then he hears something and turns around and sees Nyrex standing there. Hey there. Wasn't expecting to see you. Sorry things didn't work out. All's fair, love and war and whatnot. You had your chance to play nice, but just didn't work out. Maybe he walks closer to her, and I imagine she's like floating off the edge, just standing there in the oblivion.
Sure.
He's like, things aren't all peachy keen for us either. Got a bullet wound in my chest, burns. Tortured by spirits, they say. But I've got an idea that's going to help this crew. He looks over the edge. He's like, it's a bit reckless, but you never get anywhere in the world if you don't take the first jump. And he jumps off.
We're going to leave it there for tonight.
What?
I've got to tell you guys, I don't know what all of that meant. But I'm very excited to find out next time we play with the Tin Whistles. Wow.
Blades!
Tin Whistles blow. They blow hard. Oh,
toot. Wow. Toot. Toot.
This crew is a mess.
Yeah.
I mean, wow. Troy, don't tell me one thing about what your plan is. I can't wait to just start a score next time that I think involves rescuing Archibald, but that Archibald will be part of from the inside. And we'll find out. This game, like, it lets you stretch so much in the different directions you can go. And at the top of the session, I'll be honest with you. I was like, oh my God, there's all this bookkeeping and it's hard to keep it all straight. But then like once things start clicking into place, it all works so well together. And one thing kind of topples a domino into something else. And we end up with I think we told a great story tonight. So thank you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jared.
Thank you, Jared. You're the best.
Great job, guys. My gosh.
It was awesome.
Bi-weekly starting next week.
Bi-weekly starting next week, twice a week at 3 a.m. on Thursdays and 6 a.m. on Wednesdays. The Glass Cannon Network, you should check out everything they do because they have incredible adventures going all the time in all different types of games. Ross Bryant, you can see more of him here and listen for him on the Stereo app where we're all doing shows now.
We are. Yeah.
Ross. Yeah. I mean, sign up for Stereo and find us because Glass Cannon has a show. I've done a show with secret GM Clinton Trucks on there. And then Ross, you do some incredible improv on there. So check that out. I'm going to go fix the wiring in my house.
Those six irons you have running.
Yeah. I don't know what's going on tonight in Highland Park, California, but I will say just thank you one more time, and I'll say goodbye to my players for now. Thank you guys so much.
Good night, Jared.
Thank you.
Good night.
Jared.
Good
night.
Thanks for watching. Job. We have some GM notes to go over here, and then we will. And then I'll tell you a ghost story. Guys, Tuesdays are Thaco Tuesdays here on the Stream of Blood. At 7 p.m. Tuesday, we're streaming 1980s-style BX D&D with Adam Conover of Adam Ruins Everything. This time we'll have actress RPG streamer Josephine McAdam and Stream of Blood's secret game master, Clint, who it turns out is a secret genius game player. I knew that, but maybe our viewers didn't know that yet. Thursday at 4 p.m. on the Stereo app is our chat series, Campaign Promises, where Secret GM Clint and I challenge each other to run our dream role-playing campaigns and take your live questions. Download the Stereo app at the link in the chat, and don't forget to hashtag eat booty. And come back to Twitch at 7 p.m. Pacific for a new eerie adventure of the Neptune Society. And for this arc, our keeper will not be me, Jared Logan. It will be none other than Neptune veteran Andrew Orvidal. Andrew has a really cool, really exciting adventure planned, and I can't wait for you guys to check it out. And we're going to have a great cast for that as well. On Sunday at 6 p.m. Pacific, it's time for more Blood and Blades in our shared setting. Next time, we're going to have the Kino Hora, our Better Than Heroes crew. And last time, they wrecked an entire neighborhood with a golem. Now we're going to have a little downtime. And then, of course, tomorrow at 10 a.m., be here when I won't need as much lighting for our Vampires of Pittsburgh Lockdown show. Vampires of Pittsburgh Lockdown, we left on a huge cliffhanger last week. They are assaulting the Camarilla Haven at River Run Properties on Washington's Landing. Lots of things could go wrong. Lots of things could go right. Please be sure to check it out and tune in with us here 10 a.m. tomorrow. 10 a.m. Pacific time. Stream of Blood is a podcast as well, and we would love for you guys to subscribe, rate, and review it. Leave a review. Our podcast covers all the back episodes of Vampires of Pittsburgh, so you can catch up on our 40-plus part saga and know where we're at right now. Blades in the Dark is from Evil Hat Productions and game designer John Harper. Original music for Blood and Blades series is by Axel Cazes Taylor. You can check out more of Axel's stuff at SoundCloud. You could spread the word about the Stream of Blood by helping us. And the way you can help us is to join our social media channels. We're on Twitter. We're on Twitch. You should subscribe for special benefits like our faction turn. We are on Instagram. We are on Facebook. We are especially on Discord, where I'd love for you all to join and come and talk to me about the games and what you thought of them. Our Discord is the server of Blood, and that is where you can become a subscriber and work on those Blood and Blades faction turns and control one of the gangs of Duskvol. For example, tonight we knew Bear was going to retaliate because the person controlling Bear decided to retaliate. So that's how that's working. I have time for maybe one question while I go through very quickly my thank yous. I want to thank Brian Baldinger and Clinton Trucks. Those are my producers and partners. I want to thank our social media manager, Megan Arch. I want to thank YouTube content producer, Matt Moynihan. Our Stream of Blood logo was created by Garrett Ross, and our opening animation is by Andrew Orvidal. Does anybody have a final comment or question to take us out on? Best episode so far, but really that happens every time. Wow, what a very nice thing to say, Mediocre Gatsby. You know what? You're not mediocre. You're a stellar Gatsby. And I can put so much of the quality of this particular game on my own shoulders. It's because we have such great, amazing players whom I clearly learn from the whole time. Checked out Scum and Villainy, the space opera Blades in the Dark hack. It's pretty great. Loki, guess what? Right now, as we sit here together, I'm going to say that we will put some Scum and Villainy on the Stream of Blood. Maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow, but soon. And bi-weekly, maybe not bi-weekly, but maybe for like a quick, you know, 1 month little saga or something, because you're like the third person. And if there is a space Blades in the Dark, I've got to play it. Thanks for a great session. Did you plan out the toy scene in advance? So I have, not to let you too much behind the curtain, because I don't think GMs should do that. I have hooks kind of lined up in different places, based on people that they've met and the people who are their contacts on their sheet. So I have like a list, and I don't have to even change them every time. Like if they don't hit one or don't talk to that person, I just leave it there. And the little ghost girl was waiting to show them something. The little ghost girl from the very first episode of Blood and Glass had an agenda in the city of Duskfall. There was a reason that she came here. That's been waiting a while. It's been waiting a while, but they finally started to get entangled with her in an interesting way. And then I was able to bring that hook to the fore. Quick explanation of the game setting, Visceral. The best thing you could do is to look it up online, but there is a really great line right at the beginning of the book. Let's see if I can read it here in the dark. Books in the dark, to let you know what the basic gist of the game is. You got to own this game, by the way. You're in a haunted Victorian-era city trapped inside a wall of lightning powered by demon blood. You're in a haunted Victorian-era city trapped inside a wall of lightning powered by demon blood. That's going to be my description of the setting for you right now. Wow, what an incredible question at the end of a stream to be like, could you explain the entire setting? Go. Has Jared seen the new Lois and Clark Superman series? Clancy, you know I'm a giant Superman fan, and I actually like The Flash and Supergirl on the CW, so I probably will check it out. I don't know if I love the new Superman. I don't know if I love him. I don't know if I love the CW Superman. Is it good? Let's talk about it on Discord. Guys, I love you all. Thank you again to my partners and social media managers and everybody. Thank you. And until next time, I'll see you in Duskfall. Goodbye. Oh, bye-bye. See ya.